This is KGW News at Sunrise.
A woman assaulted outside of Unity Health Center in Northeast Portland is now suing the psychiatric facility. We spoke with her lawyer, who says the man that attacked her was released that same day and the warning signs were clear. Plus,
it is the season. It's that part of session. The gun control, or actually gun owner control, advocates are in full force.
Right now in Salem, Oregon lawmakers are considering a new gun control bill. Critics say it's a copy of Measure 114, which remains stuck in the court system.
And it is sneaking up on us. We're just a few weeks away from tax day. To take the pressure off, though, we're giving you six interesting facts about it, including some that could save you money.
All right, I got my return in. Finally, I'm a little late.
You did.
Yes.
Yes, and you?
No.
Okay. Pressure's on.
2-1.
To take Christine out to lunch.
There you go. Hey, good morning, everybody. Middle of the week on a Wednesday. I ran into some fog on my drive-in.
Yeah, a little foggy out there in spots. Nothing widespread or being reported as bad, but good to know that. Here's a look at radar, and we see showers. This is around that upper level low in California, coming up from the south, rotating back to the east. So right now, a little bit of rain, mostly north of the Columbia. Here's some showers that have passed through the Longview area. Our forecast today does include a spotty shower chance, but overall, we're looking at a pretty nice, partly cloudy, dry day. Here's a look at some of the fog layers. You can make out a little bit from the Wells Fargo building. We're at 40 right now out at the airport. We'll be 49 at noon. I have us in the upper 50s for high today. Winds will be light, and again, overall, a pretty nice Wednesday. Back to you.
Rob, thank you. A Portland woman hit in the head with a 35-pound rock is now suing the psychiatric hospital that treated her alleged attacker. She says there were warning signs he was dangerous, yet he was released the same day she was attacked. Now she hopes her lawsuit will stop something like this from happening again. Here's KGW's Alma McCarty.
August 9th, 2022. Sonia Gonzalez was standing outside Unity Center for Behavioral Health in the Lloyd District.
Minding her own business, waiting for a ride home, when a man who was unknown to her came up behind her and hit her in the head with a 35-pound rock.
Her attorney, Peter Jancy, explains she fell over, hit her head again on a concrete wall, and was knocked unconscious, bleeding on the sidewalk.
Unfortunately, no one came to her aid, and she was forced to seek shelter on her own and to try to get the attention of security personnel from Unity.
After the attack, Gonzalez suffered a concussion and needed 10 staples in her skull. According to the lawsuit, doctors later diagnosed her with PTSD, and due to the extent of these injuries, she remains on long-term disability leave. This allegedly at the hands of 40-year-old Dwayne Simpson, a patient discharged from Unity that very day. At the time, Portland police said the attack was random, but it wasn't the first time they've dealt with Simpson. Court documents showed threatening 911 calls a month prior.
There are multiple witnesses and police reports that indicate that this individual was making threats, in fact, making very specific threats about wanting to hurt women and wanting to bash someone's head in with a rock. And that's exactly what he did. So the question is, what did Unity or Legacy know about the danger that he posed? And if it was known to them that he was making these types of threats, how did they reach the decision to release him back into the community?
KGW reached out to Unity Center. A spokesperson replied, writing, "We are unable to comment on pending litigation." Though feeling fortunate she survived, Gonzalez's attorney said she hopes the suit will stop an unprovoked attack from happening to someone else.
That's a question that a lot of people that live in our community have right now, is how are we responding to a larger mental health crisis? My client's very concerned that if there were failures and if there were breaches in proper protocol, that those get addressed so that this kind of thing can't be repeated.
Alma McCarty, KGW News.
Now to the latest on a triple homicide we've been following since it happened Saturday. We now know two of the people who died were Portland high school students. Eskender Tamra is on the right-hand side of your screen. He was a junior at Franklin High. And Isaac Dowdy on the left was a former Franklin student who went to Roosevelt this year. 20-year-old Patrick D. Johnson Jr. was identified as the third person killed. Police say they were shot in broad daylight while they were inside a car on North Foss Avenue. We have not heard of any arrests. There is a GoFundMe set up now to help Isaac's family cover funeral costs. The description says they want to give him the memorial that he deserves.
This morning, there is a growing memorial near the Covenant School in Nashville. Later today, thousands are expected to attend a city-sponsored memorial remembering the three children and three adults who were shot to death on campus Monday morning.
Police killed the shooter. Coming up on the Today Show, investigators say the attacker legally bought seven guns from five different stores in the area while under doctor supervision for an emotional disorder.
Good morning. The makeshift memorial is growing outside of the Covenant School here in Nashville, Tennessee, the site of yet another mass shooting. Today, we are learning more about the victims, the young students, as well as the adults with deep ties with this school community. And police are also releasing more information about the shooter, saying that the individual targeted the school, but it's still unclear why. We'll have much more on the investigation coming up on Today.
Back in Oregon, lawmakers are debating a gun control bill that basically mirrors Measure 114, which voters narrowly passed in November. That measure meant Oregon would have some of the strictest gun laws in the country, but since passing, it has been stuck in the courts. Evan Watson looked into the details of the latest gun control bill.
The debate is back. What should Oregon do about guns? And if it feels all too familiar to you, Republican State Senator Kim Thatcher would agree.
It is the season. It's that part of session. The gun control, or actually gun owner control, advocates are in full force. They basically say, in essence, we need these laws in the name of public health and safety. And the other side says these proposals will have little effect on public health and safety, but will make law-abiding citizens less safe.
In November, Oregon voters passed Measure 114, banning high-capacity magazine sales and creating a permitting and background check system to buy guns. Measure 114 is being contested in court. Now lawmakers are considering Senate Bill 348. It includes parts of Measure 114 and then adds more regulations. Senate Bill 348 would raise the minimum age to purchase a gun to 21, postpone the permit requirement until July of 2024, raise permit fees from $65 to $150, add gun safety course requirements, and allow more time for background checks and waiting periods for gun transfers. Thatcher and other critics say this bill could circumvent the legal challenges to Measure 114.
Constitutionality of the provisions of this measure have been challenged and are being challenged, and yet this bill will short-circuit that process.
This amendment goes beyond ballot Measure 114's already unconstitutional requirements, like the increase in fees, time, delay, age restriction increases, and retroactive magazine bans.
Elizabeth Howe, a representative for Oregon Alliance for Gun Safety, said the bill would create a safer system of permits and background checks that gives police more money and structure to make it work.
The Dash 1 amendment to Senate Bill 348 makes some important changes to aid in the implementation of the new permit system and ensures that law enforcement has the tools and resources they need to implement the measure.
Most of the speakers at Monday's public hearing oppose the bill.
These measures are disenfranchising Oregonians and making them feel as though they have no voice in their government. I pray that you will let Senate Bill 348 die.
And hundreds of people have submitted written testimony online, mostly in opposition.
I had a customer come into my store, and she was scared. She had a threatening neighbor. Police couldn't do anything because they hadn't harmed anybody yet. With this bill going through, she'd have to wait days, and she didn't have days.
Evan Watson, KGW News.
If you have an opinion on this bill, the Senate Judiciary Committee is still accepting written testimony through tonight at 5 o'clock. It'll hold a work session on SB 348 tomorrow.
Now to a bizarre story you may have seen online. Portland police say a man was driving this stolen forklift downtown yesterday. They say he was driving erratically and he even started chasing pedestrians. Central Precinct officers found him traveling the wrong way on Southwest Harvey Milk and 4th Avenue. He was arrested. No word yet if he'll face any charges. Well, this is a big day over in Warm Springs. The area's only skate park reopens this morning at 11. Organizers say it's taken 2 years to make this happen, and it was all thanks to a grassroots effort. Again, the grand reopening is at 11 o'clock at Elmer Quinn Memorial Park. The Confederated Tribes of Warm Springs will celebrate with a blessing, a ribbon cutting, food giveaways, and of course, skateboarding.
Is the weather going to be pretty good for getting out today, right?
Yeah, absolutely. That's a pretty good action shot.
Yeah, I loved it.
Like, whoa.
I could never stand up on a skateboard.
Yeah, mainly dry today and tomorrow. You know, on paper it looks dry, then the weather models are going, ah, there could be a spotty shower, and we have showers up in Kelso Longview area right now. We are tracking that low still offshore, but it has dropped all the way down off the Northern California coastline, so it's cleared our area, but look how wide the circulation is. This is the outer band moving south to north and then coming back to the east across Washington. Now, as the low continues to move to the south, which it will today, even these outer bands that are now impacting parts of our area, there's the Dalles and up in Cowlitz County and Columbia County, will weaken. So, you know, I really think most of us will just stay dry today. And generally speaking, it will be a partly cloudy day. Just don't be surprised if you catch a shower. Again, there's Longview getting a shower in just the last little bit. We have some fog. You can see the lights from the Tilcom Crossing. Now you can't. 40 degrees from the top of the Wells Fargo building. Here are the other numbers. 39 Astoria. So far on the west side, it's chilly, but everybody's holding above freezing. There's 37 in Salem, above freezing. Out in the Gorge as well, the Dalles 43, Hood River I think is 39 right now. Bend is at 30, 29 out in John Day, so some colder temperatures out to the east. We have snow-covered passes. Yesterday, Meadows picked up 8 inches of snow, Timberline 4, Ski Bowl just 2. It's 30 degrees right now. The pass temperatures over the Cascades will generally get up to about 40 this afternoon. So the roads will become nice and clean once the sun gets up and starts doing its thing. There will be some flurries over the mountains today. That's about it. Here's Futurecast. Generally, we're looking at a partly cloudy day with that spotty shower chance. Here we are at 3:30. Most of these showers, it shows popping over the mountains, and we'll keep a spotty shower chance in forecast tomorrow as well. Trying to get up to 58 today. It was actually 60 or even better when you got up around Seattle yesterday. So we'll try to warm up with the drier conditions today. 57 tomorrow, again, a spotty shower chance. Friday morning looks to be dry. Rain picks up in the afternoon. The front comes in Friday night. This should be a good soak. A solid rain band, very rainy Friday night, including the evening hours. Should be over a half of an inch for us. And then that leads to these colder temps returning. 50 on Saturday, maybe. 48 on Sunday and 48 on Monday as we get into Washington's chilly spring break. Oregon may be glad to be back to work and glad to be back in school. Who knows?
I don't know. Time off is always good. Rob, thank you.